Ladies and gentlemen, welcome. Please take your seats. The session is about to begin.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Greg Beer from the Grable Foundation.
Good afternoon. Welcome to GEO, everyone. This conference is about you and what you can do to what you already do and do it better. Smarter grant making, stronger nonprofits, better results, that's GEO. It's also about what you will do to speed the pace of innovation in philanthropy in support of making ever more meaningful differences in the lives of the people and the communities whom we're blessed to serve. Every one of you has expertise in this room. Every one of you has knowledge to share with every one of us. So during this conference, speak up, mingle, have fun, and participate. During 4 plenary sessions, 39 breakouts, and 4 site visits, you'll witness extraordinary, as well as very ordinary things that work really well. You'll learn about honest-to-goodness actual collaborations and partnerships. You'll talk plainly about money and about people. You'll have ideas about unleashing the potential of philanthropy. So I really want you to pipe up and get involved. In fact, you'll want to do these things. Now, I have a great slideshow here for you. You'll want to do these things because of the people in this room. Now, some of you, incredibly half of you, are first-time attendees. So, would all of the rookies, GEO rookies in this room, please stand up? If this is your first GEO conference, please stand up. It's absolutely fantastic. Welcome to GEO. And I hope your GEO experience is as motivating and inspiring as it has been for me and for so many others in this room. Now, 25% of you are participating as ambassadors. So if you're an ambassador, would you please stand up? Or an ambassador D. I want to thank this group for building the camaraderie of this very special community of people. Now, 10% of you, 10% hail from right here in the Keystone State. So, my fellow Pennsylvanians, I want to thank you for being the incredible hosts. I know that you have been and that you will be. Thank you. 10% of you come from New York State. And some of us are hoping you brought along some black and white cookies for all of us. Now, incredibly, 19% of you traveled from the Golden State of California. So if you're craving fish tacos while you're here, I can assure you, you'll find incredibly good fish tacos at the Penn Avenue Fish Company, and that guy's the owner. Now, wonderfully, five of you came all the way from New Zealand. Where are you? So I think you automatically earn our respect as the coolest people in this room. And 24 of you managed to overcome your Olympics hangover and cross that border to our north. So I want to welcome you to the home of the Stanley Cup and the home of Sidney Crosby and Mario Lemieux. Please keep sending your best hockey players to Pittsburgh. Of course, we owe this special chance to come together to some people and organizations. And I want to begin by thanking and introducing GEO's President and CEO, Kathleen Enright, and the GEO staff. Please also join me in recognizing GEO's outstanding Board of Directors. If the Board of Directors would please stand. And on behalf of the board, I want to thank Carrie Avery, our conference planning chair. Thank you, Carrie. And And finally, please join me in a loud round of applause for our sponsors. Together, they've committed more to this conference than any other GEO conference in GEO's history. So thank you to our sponsors. More than anything, I want to welcome you to my hometown of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. So while you're here, get out of the hotel and see this remarkably resilient and vibrant city. Point State Park is right outside the front door, and this is where Generals Washington, Braddock, and Forbes defeated the French in the Clash of the Empires. From there, you can look across the river to the Carnegie Science Center, home to the world's largest robotic exhibition. You can also see Heinz Field, home to more Lombardi trophies than any other NFL city. Or you may want to cross the Clemente Bridge on 6th Street, past the most beautiful ballpark in America, and walk along the Allegheny until you come to Pittsburgh's newest memorial to our beloved Fred Rogers. Or maybe cross one of the Three Sisters Bridges over to the Andy Warhol Museum, or the award-winning Children's Museum of Pittsburgh. While you're there, make sure you get a shaved ice from Gus and Yaya. Of course, you may want to stay inside the Golden Triangle. And if that's the case, wind your way through the maze of construction that's outside the door, and you'll find Market Square. In Market Square, you'll find my favorite coffee shop and my favorite bakery. Or walk down Penn Avenue, home to the world's one of the world's most incredibly vibrant arts districts. And at the Symphony, you'll find my fiance, Yu Ling. We're getting married 2 months from today, everyone. Now, for those of you who are slightly more adventurous, take the walk down Penn Avenue to 21st Street, and you'll find yourself in the heart of what's called the Strip District. And there's no better place to know what Pittsburgh is all about than in the Strip District. And so while you're there, have a Primanti's sandwich. They put the fries and the slaw in it. Or you might want to go where President Obama loves to go, to Pamela's, and get some of the world's best pancakes. Speaking of Mr. Obama, he and 25 presidents and prime ministers visited us just last September as Pittsburgh played host to the G20 summit. The world will call again this June as Pittsburgh hosts World Environment Day. Indeed, the world is again taking note of this remarkable city nestled in the hills and valleys of western Pennsylvania. Places Rated Almanac rates Pittsburgh as America's most livable city. So too does The Economist. And historian David McCullough famously described Pittsburgh as the indispensable American city. Yesterday's smoky city is now Roboburg. It's the new emerald green city. It's Kidsburg. It's Pop City. It's art. It's the city of champions. It's even Little Hollywood. Of course, this city of bridges will always be the Steel City. And we proudly embrace that innovative past as we look forward to a brilliant future. So in this spirit of Renaissance, let us invent some more, together, right here in Pittsburgh, today, tomorrow, and for times to come. So to all of you, I welcome you to our neighborhood, where it's a beautiful day every day. Thank you for being here. Thank you. And it's now my honor to introduce a veteran strategist and grantmaker, a former GEO trustee, and an inspiring leader. She's joining us from Atlanta, where she serves as chief executive of the Southern Partners Fund. Ladies and gentlemen, Ms. Janine Lee.
Well, thank you, Greg. And it's wonderful to be here in your hometown. Always love coming into Pittsburgh, the city that kind of opens its arms to embrace and welcome all of us as we come through the tunnels. This, for me, is my 7th GEO conference, and although I am certainly thrilled to be here and to see the size and energy of the group in this room. I just want to say that I'm particularly proud of Kathleen and the board and the entire team at GEO. I think this is going to be an amazing, extraordinary 3 days together. Our opening plenary focuses on empathy. And this is a core value at Southern Partners Fund, where I have the privilege of serving as the president and CEO. And although we're based in Atlanta, Georgia, we do serve rural grassroots communities from throughout the southeastern United States that really focus on social, economic, and environmental inequities in the South. We embrace two central ideas. Those would be compassion and community. And we strive to have empathy as we work with community members who lack the political power and wherewithal often to impact decisions in their communities. And we bring them together to bring voice and through self-determination so that they can create solutions to deeply rooted social problems. GEO has long prodded grantmakers to build in feedback mechanisms and or on-the-ground experiences that will help us build empathy and ultimately make better decisions. This is an area that our keynote speaker knows very well, and he's going to share a little bit more about that with us in just a minute. So I'd like to introduce Thave Patnaik, who is the founder of Jump Associates, a growth strategy firm. He recently authored Wired to Care, How Companies Prosper When They Create Widespread Empathy, based on insights he generated as an advisor to major corporations such as Hewlett-Packard, Target, Nike, and GE. Whether a corporate leader, grantmaker, or parent, we can all benefit from viewing the world through other people's eyes. Thave's work provides us with insights and ideas that will help us do just that in our journey to become better grantmakers and nonprofit leaders. Please join me in welcoming Thave to the podium.
Hey, tell me your name again.
Thank you very much.
Good afternoon. Was that like the best opening speech you've ever heard? I mean, it was like an Olympics bid or something like that for Pittsburgh. It's fantastic. How many of you love your hometown as much as Greg does? Wow, you know, I need to work on my own kind of like up with San Mateo kind of pitch, because it's not that good compared to what you have. Thank you very much you know, for coming to this. It is amazing that GEO has the kind of turnout that you all do, considering the economy, considering where people's budgets are, and yet there seems to be a passion and a commitment to actually making the organizations that you work with more effective in what you do. So number one, give yourselves a hand for the just turning out in the midst of all this craziness and recommitting yourself to what GEO believes in. Thank you very much for that. I want to talk to you about empathy today. Are they going to put up a slide? Yeah, there you go. There's a slide. Because I can't talk without PowerPoint. I'm functionally mute. But it's interesting. I want to spend time on this idea of empathy. And I think it's something that all of us in this room understand. We wouldn't be in the jobs that we do if we didn't have an understanding of empathy. But I got a new view into it today. As I was talking to Danielle before we started, apparently you're supposed to pretend that your translator is invisible or something, you're not here. But she's right here. And so you'll notice something, which is that when I use the word empathy, she does this, which is super cool. Because I asked her, what is that all about? She's like, that's the word for empathy. It means I get where you are. And I thought, that is perfect. I thought the sign language so beautifully expresses this idea of empathy. So we want to spend some time talking about it today, but hopefully we'll do it in a way that becomes incredibly useful and incredibly powerful for the work that you all do. I am not a very empathic person myself. I should start with that as a background. I remember when I was writing Wired to Care, my wife told me, she said, you know, you're going to write this book, and pretty soon you will be known as Dr. Empathy, and only you and I will know how truly ironic that is. And I thought, okay, fine. But I want to tell you about why this is so important to the work I do, even though it doesn't come second nature to me. You see, just by way of introduction about me, this is me. If you were standing closer to me, this is what I would look like. And if you started talking to me, you would discover very quickly that I am indeed not a nonprofits guy, not a foundations guy. That's my brother, my co-founder of Jump. He is here. He's the foundations guy. I am a capitalist pig. But relatively, oh wow, there's two of us now. So this is actually a pretty different audience for me to spend time with, because usually I spend time with other capitalist pigs, but I tend to be the only pinko in the room. And so by comparison, people who actually believe that there's a mandate for social change, for something greater than ourselves, is something that I am a lone voice in when I spend time with very large corporations. You see, I wasn't always a capitalist pig. There was a time in my life where I was a broad idealist and I wanted to change the world. And I went to school in California, which is a good start for thinking about those kind of things. And at some point, I left California and I went to Pune, India, after I graduated from college. And I spent time in India in the early 90s. And it was an amazing time to be in India because the country had just gone broke. And so it was opening up its systems. It was going from an old socialist model to becoming a new, yes, capitalist model for how a country should react. And being there during those years in the late 80s and early 90s, I got to see fundamentally different behaviors in a very tangible way. I got to understand what the benefits of capitalism were like. I went there as a product designer, and I remember we hired a guy to make models for us. And at the time, there were no professional model makers. You know, these are guys to do mechanical engineering models. But we found a guy who his previous life had been carving religious sculptures, wooden elephant-headed gods and such, as was his training, as his father's training, and his father's training before him for generations. This is what they did. And so carving our models were so simple compared to those elephant sculptures that he had done before. And I remember the first time he came to our offices, he had to take two different buses and walk for a quarter of a mile to get to our office. And then within a year, he was coming to visit us, but he was coming on a bicycle because he had learned a bicycle by that point. And a year later, he was coming on a motorcycle. And a year after that, I was told that he was driving a car, but I didn't get to see it because he stopped coming. He was sending two of his guys to meet me. Right? And so the power of capitalism was incredibly tangible to me. And overnight, I started to see that there was a power to actually transform lives in the work that we were doing. Now, at the time, though, what was also clear to me was that there was a difference between making money and creating wealth. And that creating wealth and making money are not the same things. And maybe some of the trauma that we've experienced in the last two or three years in our society suggests that we have confused the two and found that the two are interchangeable when they are, in fact, not interchangeable. So unlike most capitalist pigs, I will not stand up here and tell you over the next 45 minutes why you should all think like corporations and be more like businesses. Have you heard that before? Yes or no? Yeah, okay, so I'm not going to bore you with that crap, because I think there's a limitation to thinking like businesses. There are good things about businesses, but some of the stuff that you all do is so much better, and that's what I want to spend some time on talking about with you all today. You see, the work that I do in my day job at Jump Associates is all around this idea of innovation. We help companies to find out new ways to innovate and to grow, and they come to us with very ambiguous questions. Car companies are trying to dig themselves out of the craters that they have created for themselves. And cookie companies wake up and say, oh my God, people aren't eating junk anymore like they used to. We should probably be about health and wellness. What does that mean? And even places like the San Diego Zoo and other nonprofits come to us because the San Diego Zoo says, we actually need to own conservation in a way that we have ceded to people like the Discovery Channel. And what are things that we could do in our realm as well? So it does translate into the realm of things beyond just for-profit corporations. And yet all of these folks have a fundamental question that they ask us. And it's the question that drove me to think about this idea of empathy, which is they all want to know how they can grow sustainably, time and time again, year after year, in good times and bad. And they ask us, well, what are the things we can rely on? What are the sources of growth that are enduring, that we can stick to, that if we know we master these traits, we will succeed year after year, and it's not just a single fad, it's not just something we can do for today, and then we have to switch. And we've done a lot of research at Chomp as to what it takes to be a master of innovation, to be truly great at growth. And I can show you all sorts of boring Excel charts that kind of sum it up for you. But because it would be impolite to show Excel over lunch, I'll sum it up in three things, which is that if you want to innovate, if you want to grow, you need three things. You need a great amount of empathy for the outside world. You need a deep connection for the people around you. You need a fair bit of creativity, the ability to generate ideas that people have not thought of before, ways of getting things done that no one has tried. And we need a fair bit of execution, the ability to get things done. And when I looked around the world, I saw a lot of books that had been written about creativity. Literally, there are thousands of books on creativity. If you want to know more about it, just pick one of them up. They all say the same thing. They're all very good, right? And if you want to know something about execution, there's some excellent books on execution. There's a book by Ram Charan that I love, and it's called, wait for it, Execution. And it's how to get things done, right? This is a no BS kind of guy. Read Execution. But there were not a whole lot of people talking about empathy, and certainly not talking about it in the realm that I lived in, which is the realm of corporations and businesses, and particularly in the idea of saying that maybe the secret to actually growing as an organization is to have an empathic connection for the world around us. Because when myself and my partners, when we looked around at the firms that we had worked with, and we said, what was the defining difference between companies that were able to transform themselves and to grow and to innovate, and those places that weren't able to do so, those places where our recommendations end up as just being PowerPoint documents that sat in file drawers collecting dust, the difference was their ability to empathize for the world around them, their ability to have an intuition and a gut sense for the ordinary people that they ultimately served, the people who had a stake in their success. Now, every single one of us in this room has an understanding of what the word empathy means, right? Because we are all born with this ability. Every single one of us is blessed with the ability by our Creator to step outside of ourselves and walk in someone else's shoes, to intuitively get where they're coming from, to see the world as they do. And yet, when we get together in larger organizations, and it doesn't matter whether they are for-profit or non-profit foundations, wealthy or poor, something strange starts to happen, which is that instinct starts to get short-circuited. And suddenly, organizations start to look very insular, academic institutions start to look like ivory towers, political organizations start to take on a bunker mentality, and before you know it, we're all talking to ourselves rather than talking to the people who matter most in the world. Now, I also moonlight for extra money down the road at Stanford University. I teach in the design school there, so it's important that I talk in case studies as well, because that's how professors talk. So I want to share with you a case study to give you an example of what I'm talking about. And I'm going to use a corporation, but it's a corporation that we all know, and that is Microsoft. How many of you have used a Microsoft product before? Yeah, right. How many of you liked using it? It's an interesting, not as many people. Microsoft, you may remember in the mid-90s that Microsoft was the king of the hill. They had successfully beaten the heck out of folks like IBM and Apple and Netscape for dominance of the personal computer. They owned the desktop, so much so that they had raised the suspicions of the Justice Department. But they were kings of the hill, and when they looked around, they suddenly saw a threat that they hadn't counted on before. And that threat came in the form of this thing, the announcement of the upcoming Sony PlayStation 2. And this scared Microsoft to death. You see, up until this point, things like the PlayStation, game consoles were just that, games. They were toys. They were things for kids to play with. But this thing was going to be different. The PlayStation was going to have a connection to the web so you could browse the internet on it. and it was going to have a DVD player so you could watch movies on it. And if Sony's promise fulfilled, it promised to become the entertainment center of the home, the kind of digital media hub which everyone would connect to, and maybe people didn't need to buy a personal computer at all, they could just buy a PlayStation 2. And so you can see why this frightened Microsoft tremendously, because after working so hard to own the personal computer, they suddenly realized that maybe the PC was irrelevant, and they knew they had to act. So they got together, and they formulated a plan, and they decided that what they were going to do was to create a game console of their own. Now, the challenge for Microsoft to come up with a games console cannot be underestimated, because although philosophers and theologians all agree that Microsoft is indeed richer than God, there was the Gates Foundation people in the room, anyone? Yes? They nonetheless knew that this was going to be a challenge for them, right? Which is that Microsoft knows a lot about software, but they don't know that much about hardware. And Microsoft knows a lot about the world of work and office and things that we all have to do, but they don't know that much about play and fun and things that we want to do. And so they said, okay, we have to do something different. So they got together a group of people, many of them who had not worked at Microsoft before, but they just loved to play games. And they put them in a separate office off campus from the rest of Microsoft. And they said, you can break the rules with this thing. Come up with a game console. It doesn't matter if it runs on Windows. It's okay if we can't use Microsoft Word on this thing, but just come up with an amazing game console. And so that's what those guys did. And they went to it with such passion because they loved to play video games. Now, I should say, they didn't just like to play any kind of video game. The folks who worked on the Microsoft project loved a particular kind of video game. They loved the kind of rated M for mature video game that is played by guys who are about 35 years old with the brains of 15-year-olds who really love to get together with their buddies on a Saturday and kill each other, right? They love to travel to far-off weird science fiction planets and see aliens and blow them up, right? And the more violence and the more guts and the more bombs, the happier they were, because that's how they acted out all of their aggression and all of their frustrations. And they looked at the Sony PlayStation thing and they thought, yeah, this is okay if you want to romp through some magical fairy forest collecting mushrooms and talking to Smurfs, right? That's okay, but we're going to make something different. We're going to make something more hardcore than that. So that's what they did. And they went at it, and 2 years later, they launched what became known as the Microsoft Xbox. And the Xbox was an overnight success. It was that kind of intensely violent, kind of hardcore gaming machine that they had sought to create. It sold in excess of 24 million units worldwide. And its signature game, Halo, was sold out overnight. For weeks, you couldn't get this thing. And particularly notable was the fact that the Xbox was the first successful game console by an American company in over a generation. Anyone remember the last successful American game box? Can you remember Atari, right? How many of you remember Atari? Yeah. Okay, so if you remember Atari, you are old, okay? Because kids don't remember, your kids don't remember what Atari is. Atari was a long time ago. So this was a big deal for Microsoft, right? To come up with something that no one had done in a generation. So impressed were they with themselves that they knew exactly what they wanted to do when they came across their next competitive threat. And that came in the form of something that launched in 2000 as well. That was the iPod. How many of you have an iPod? Yes, it's almost like taking a census. You know, you can just look around. How many of you have an iPod? We could drive the census through the iPod, actually, or in the iPhone, and we would, you know, we'd be able to count everybody. You wouldn't have to mail anything in. And looking at this, they knew that they were onto something. They said, we have to go after this. This thing, in its first 5 years, sold 60 million iPods. And so Microsoft said, ha, we know exactly what we're going to do. And so they took a group of people, many of whom were the same people who had worked on Xbox, and they sent them off campus. They put them together. They said, break all the rules, guys. Do whatever you want. Just come up with something amazing. Just kill iPod. Do what you did to Sony, to Apple. So they worked hard at it, and they worked for about 2 years, and they finally launched what became known as the Microsoft Zune. How many of you have a Zune? Is there? Wow, there's one. Okay, so that's like half the market right there. The Zune was slow, it was ugly, it was hard to install. As one online reviewer said, the process of installing a Zune on your personal computer is about as pleasurable as having an airbag explode in your face. Ouch. Right? And not surprisingly, in its first 18 months, the Zune sold about 2 million units. Now, to give you some sense of scale, in that same 18 months, Apple sold in excess of 84 million iPods. For those of you not working in the for-profit world,